business cycles struck. At this point, those in business are innovative and cautious. They see a few chances of improved opportunities over the near term. Output is low, sales in both domestic and export markets are depressed, profits and stock prices have fallen, and there is excess plant capacity and high unemployment. Consumer confidence is low, with many big ticket purchases, such as a new car, postponed. Towards the end of the drought phase, a few signs of recovery begins to appear. These often include a bottoming in business inventories, low interest rates, decrease inflation, improved credit availability, stabilizing stock prices.
So, this is a starting point. Then, the next phase. So, the next phase, which
recovery and expansion. There are usually two phases of expansion. Recession is a game. If the second phase, expansion exceeds the previously measured high. At the start of the recovery, interest rates, wages, and inventory costs are low enough to bring unit costs of production significantly below selling prices. Thus, profits improve even with reduced levels of production. Economic activity increases with renewed consumer spending and housing construction. More sectors of economy start participating in the expansion. Manufacturing industries begin producing higher levels of durable goods. Construction activity strengthens, and assuming a worldwide recovery, export markets expand rapidly. Employment is rising, but still high unemployment keeps the increase in labor costs down. In the second stage of expansion, the economy moves beyond the previous peak. Inflation is still low, but is moderately rising in some sectors. Businesses have adjusted inventories to meet higher demand and capacity restraints now begin to appear. In various industries, major increases in capital expenditure becomes necessary to increase capacity to meet higher demand. Expansion of plant and equipment is necessary to avoid shortages. Corporate profit prices and stock market activity strong. Most industries are identified by the product or service they provide. As a first step in fundamental analysis, it is common practice to select industries which are likely to perform best during a given period, say 12 to 14 months, and then to select individual companies which are likely to be those industries.
So first, we talked about the economic analysis. So as when you are selecting, it is when you are selecting a stock for investment, three very important parameters are the economy. If the economy is not doing well, industry will not do well. If the industry is not doing well, companies will not do well. And if companies are not doing well, stocks will not do well. The reverse is that if the economy is doing well, industries will do well. If industries are doing well, companies will do well. And if companies are doing well, stocks will do well. So this is the first parameter that you have to look at an economy. If you look at stocks, ignoring the economy, then your results could be disastrous. As the economy has fallen from 10% or 9.5% to 4.5%, you have witnessed that over the last 5 years, there has been no return in the stock market for investors because it is ultimately linked to the economy. There can be certain companies which have. So when you look at, let us say, January 2008, the index was 21,000. Today, the 1st February 2014, what is the index? 21,000 less. Which means that the index comprises of 30 best companies. So even if you have been a passive investor and invested only in the index, in 5 years, you would have got zero returns. We have invested in the best of companies because the Sensex 30 companies comprise of best companies. So ideally, if you are investing in the best companies, 5 years zero. Whereas, in fixed deposits, if you look at, you have made 5 years, so a person would analyze it this way. 5 years, 9% in fixed deposit, I made money. Stock market, I have not made money. So many people at this point of time will withdraw from the stock market and put it into fixed deposit. And we'll come to it later. but better all round pessimism when the day when everybody takes out their money from shares and invests in fixed deposit, that is the beginning of the end of the bear phase and the beginning of a bull phase. Because we are ultimately, which we'll come to later, investment in the short run is emotion, there is fear, greed and hope that determine the market. And that is what, when the Lehman Brothers collapse happened, 27th October 2008, the market was at the lowest ever, the very low. 9 March, when there was all wrong pessimism, 9 March 2009, all wrong pessimism, most of people were withdrawing money from stocks, taking it into fixed deposits. And from there onwards, the next 1 year, the market from 6,000 went up to 21,000. So when there was all wrong pessimism, because ultimately, markets in a short run are a function of emotion. There's an emotion part which is involved in the market. So when there's markets are guided by fear, hope and greed, so there's a huge fear and lack of hope, the markets at the low end, then things turn around. It is only then that the markets start going up. So one way, thumb rule is that when you find all your friends and sectors very pessimistic, you can know that the market is going. It's time that the markets. Today we are in a very stage also where there was no jubilation. On 8 January 2008, stock market 21,300, the highest lifetime high. There was a lot of jubilation from the stock market, balloons were flown up, etc., to mark that it has crossed a lifetime high. But today, on 23rd January 2013, the market crossed a lifetime high, 21,476. No jubilation, nobody knows, because pessimism, investors' mood is at a very low end, and that is a psychology. And you can take it down and just see that when investors are low, 3 months, 4 months, 6 months from now, you'll find, most likely, unless external factors come in place, that you'll find our market moving into a new bull phase. You'll have the market moving into a bull phase. And investor psychology has no, people will sell a share at 20 rupees, but buy the same share at 100 rupees. Because this is investor psychology. That now there is fear of the stock price going up. Then there's hope. And then when your neighbor is making money, you don't want to be left out. So feeling of left out comes into play. So you buy shares at any price. And therefore, in the next, so you find markets are guided by pessimism and optimism. Or panic and euphoria. So my advice always, buy on panics, sell on euphoria. Easy to say, but emotion do not happen. Emotion. Because in bull phases, we find that in bull phases, nobody looks at fundamental the value of share. In bull phases, euphoria. Euphoria does not take into consideration the fundamental of the stock. See, your stock is quoting at 60 rupees and it is worth 40 rupees. You tell somebody asks you for advice. This is what is my experience. You ask somebody, somebody asks you, what will we do? Look at a stock, it's 60, sell. So, okay, he sells it. Next 2 days or 3 days later, it goes up to 70. So he definitely is saying you sell to sell at 60, not 70, I lost money. But these shares go to 80, it'll go to 90. See, in the market there are three types of price. The shares can be fully priced, overpriced or underpriced. Now, at 70, it is overpriced. It can still get overpriced. Do 80 here, right? Because euphoria, and euphoria has no rationality involved. It has a sentiment involved. The price goes up to 80. But person then buys at 80, 90. Then the downside happens, that same share would come down to below 40, come up to 20. There are certain companies which now, then quality is important. Quality is important. In the info, in the IT sector, the Wipro, TCS, Infosys, IT sector, we are talking about sector, has given huge returns, or even recently. And there are certain companies in the IT sector which are just the reverse. The company Zylo, which was quoting at 600 a year back, today is quoting at 15 rupees. The company like Tulip, which was quoting at 200 rupees, quoting at 8 rupees. A company like Lodine, quoting at 400 rupees, today quoting at 8 rupees. And there are so many companies which identify the same industry. Therefore, analysis with companies is important. The same industry, you have companies which have worked in their fundamental. You know what is worth. You will not pay something. There are factors which you have to. There is no benchmark. There are factors which will come to you. For example, you will not pay anybody. If I was a real estate broker and I offer you a flat in Jogeshwari at the rate of Malabar Hill, would you buy it? So there you know, guess what is worth? It is worth here to 15,000 of a square feet. There is worth $50 square feet. So you don't buy it. So there's a parameter. In stocks there are no parameters. The parameters you have to take it on your own and judge a company. How do you judge a company? How strong is a company? Various factors. Maybe we come to that possibly after lunch, but we go to industry analysis. Now, this is just a very broad classification of industry. Emerging industries, growth industries, stable industries. There are three types of industries we look at.
From an investment perspective, it is helpful to identify specific industries relative to the evolution of an industry. The following categories are intended to provide a broad overview, and discretion is advised in their application, as some business require rigid categorization.
So this is a broad classification of three industries: emerging, stable industries, growth industries. But we'll come to emerging industries. See, they are not rigid classification, because an emerging industry may be a growth industry and vice versa. So the industry may be declining or an industry may be in a growth stage. So these are a broad classification when you are looking at an industry. An industry, let us say, many years back, nobody heard about the IT industry. Right? Nobody knew about the internet as an industry. The internet is a new industry. Nobody's aware, but it's emerged. But why internet emerged? There are a lot of companies which at a particular time, if you know, there are a lot of companies which came in, and there were a lot of internet bubbles also. So it was considered an emerging industry at that point of time. Now it is now from an emerging, it's a growth industry. So the classifications keep on changing as the outlook keeps on changing. Okay.
New products are being developed at all times to meet society's needs and demands. The transportation industry, in retrospect, provides an example of phases in a broad industry evolutionary process. At one time, the horse was the main means of transportation, only to be displaced by railroads, which in turn had to face competition from cars, trucks, and buses, and then from the growth of airlines. Today, rapid innovation is particularly evident in electronic applications. Typewriters have been, for the most part, replaced by word processors, record players by CD players. An emerging industry over time may evolve into any of the following broad industry categories.
See, as emerging industries are concerned, first, let us say transportation. Years ago, the horse was a main source of transportation. At that time, we didn't have airlines. Over a period of time, the transportation, the emerging industry. Today, now, if you have to travel, let us say somebody has to travel from Mumbai to, let us say, Chennai, would you take a horse or an airline? Anybody still take a horse to go to Chennai? So you wouldn't take it. No horse. So many did. What did a forefather do? Did he take an airline or a horse? So at that point of time, horse was the main means of transportation. So it shows that the world is evolving. So when you are also looking at companies and stock prices, you have to see what is evolving. Because if today I am a company, let us say, okay, we have company SpiceJet, etc. Let us say, if I am owning a company which has hundreds of horses deployed everywhere, and can I compete with SpiceJet or can I compete with Jet? Nobody will use a horse. Maybe you want to take your kit for an outing, get your finger, yes, that is a limited means of horse, but not as a means of transportation. You are going to use horse as a means of transportation. So there is an emerging. So IT industry was never there, CD players were never there, Today, when chips what you use, and today the mobile has got so many functions that you will require a camera. You will require so many applications. There, a large company like Kodak, which was one of the most popular and high growth companies, is out of business. Because today, do you require cameras? Everybody requires cameras. It's all changed. Do you require photo rolls? Nobody requires. So that industry has collapsed. We had computing obsolescence, calculators, fax machines. So evolving. So if companies evolve over a period of time, industries evolve. So as you have, the horse was a means of transportation at one point of time. From there it got this space, then you had the rail coming in, rail still. And so now you had one point of time. So today, competition. So let us even inland, if the goods have to be sent somewhere to let us place of Delhi. You have earlier when the roads were not built or you didn't have the proper roads or didn't have cars, then rails. It was rail and you have to send your goods to rail. Today rail is competition between road transport, rail transport. So we have surface, we have road transport, we have air transport, we have sea transport. So forms have. So anyway, sea transport today is very slow. But between rail and road, when you are sending goods, you have to see the cost and the time. So there's competition. Over a period of time, competition has emerged towards the railroad. Then trucks, buses. So these are various forms of innovation and evolvement. And now you have airlines. Airlines have fastest. So if cargo has to be sent by air or by road or by sea, you have option. Then you take a decision how it is being sent, what is most cost effective. But definitely airlines is faster. Then you can send something in 1 or 2 hours and reach your destination. Then typewriters all these have been replaced. That is when we come to obsolescence, we've discussed that. Okay.
Growth industry is one in which sales and earnings are consistently expanding at a faster rate than most industries. Companies in such industries are referred to as growth companies and their stocks are growth stocks. Growth stocks typically have maintained a pronounced, substantially above average rate of growth over a period of years, ordinarily in excess of 5 years, and are expected to do so. From your eyes, a price must be based on the permanent factors: high profit margins, increasing value of assets, increasing earnings, working capital, and return on equity.
Here we talk of emerging industry. Now, coming back to what I said, at one point of time, the IT industry was an emerging industry because it was a new. Today it's a growth industry. It has transformed into a growth industry. And there is phenomenal growth that is available to the IT industry. Because today, all applications are being computerized. There are new applications coming in. And today, it is the IT, whether it is a plane which is controlled by IT, pilot is controlled by IT. So IT has the applications that IT will have in the next couple of years is phenomenal. So therefore, companies like when you are selecting companies like a TCS or an Infosys or a Wipro or its leaders will keep on growing. If you look at the growth of TCS for the last 5 years, 6 years, it has been enormous. Infosys, no level slowdown, has been enormous. So these are growth industries which have been transformed from emerging industries, and their growth is going to be superlative in the next couple of years, and therefore companies operating within this industry will have huge profits. TCS has a very high margin of profit. Infosys also, Wipro, HCL Tech. So these companies have grown from scratch. Infosys as a company in 1982, Mr. Narayan Murthy started their company, borrowing as Quartos borrowed 30,000 from his sister. Narayan Murthy borrowed 50,000 from his wife and took a 500 square apartment and started Infosys. So investment 50,000, area 500 square feet. Today it has 35,000 crore turnover. hope you will surpass Infosys. So this is how, with a small investment, just a small investment, the company has been there. Many excited, but I'm talking about the IT sector. That the growth, the right time, the sector from an emerging industry has blossomed into a growth industry. So industries which are emerging can blossom into a growth industry. Therefore, I said no rigid definition, because it's growth. But there are certain industries which were emerging industries, like solvent extraction, granites, secretion. They have declined. From, you can either, from an emerging industry, you can migrate to a growth industry or to a decline industry. Or one is stable, where, okay, stable industry, where, yeah. But can be either, it can be from emerging, it can be a growth, stable, or decline. There are three options.
The following characteristics are usually associated with the terms growth stock or growth company: high rates of earnings of invested capital, retention and reinvestment of earnings, capable and aggressive management, fertile opportunity for earnings growth. A growth company should have an above average rate of earnings on invested capital over a period of years. It should also appear likely that the company will be able to continue to earn a similar, better rate on additional invested capital. The company should show increasing unit rupee sales over a period coupled with a firm control on cost.
So these are growth industry characteristics of a growth industry. A growth industry must show high rate of earnings on invested capital. Now, when you high growth of earnings on invested capital, if you invest 100 rupees, just a small denomination, then you should have a return of 30-40%. If you are having a return of 2%, 3%, you are not a growth industry. It's less than the rate of return of 60%. Plus, it has to have a high growth of then retention and reinvestment of earnings. That, let us say the company is earning 30% on invested capital. So a company which has 100 rupees investment now earns another 100 rupees. So if it puts that money back into business, it will earn 30% on that. If it pays out by way of dividend, it will be pay out dividend. It is earning more than a bank rate. It is earning. So dividend is something which will reduce its capacity to invest. So when companies earn 30-40% on capital, so if those companies, when you study it, when you look at a company, and look at a company, let us say you find a company which is earning 30% return. So if that company reinvests into plant and machinery or into for a product, it will earn 30%. And as it keeps on investing the increased earnings, it will earn a very high rate of interest, a very high rate of margin, and therefore your stock would go up because it is reinvesting the amount. But let us say a company is earning 2%. Then by earning 2%, if it retains the amount, doesn't make any sense. Might as well it pay a dividend to you, because that to retaining the earning is bringing down the overall return on the invested capital. Growth industries also are companies with aggressive management. They have to be. Now, when you come to a company like say the IT sector, you found that over a longer period of time, Infosys is holding a lot of cash. It generates a lot of cash. But that cash is not being utilized. See, either utilize our cash to expand or buy out companies. But being a conservative company, it was not buying out companies where TCS was growing faster. So at times, you require an aggressive management. Okay, management takes calculated risk. In the case of Infosys, you are finding that there is no acquisition, but in the case of Cisco, in the TCS, there are a lot of acquisitions and the company grew faster. Okay, it's almost I call stable industries.
Stable industries, these are industries in which sales and earnings are relatively stable and tend to hold up even in recession. Such companies usually have the internal resources to weather difficult economic conditions successfully. In broad terms, it is helpful to classify shares of companies in stable industries into three categories: blue chip stocks, defensive stocks, and income stocks.
So these are, there are certain like stable industries. Like, now, even despite the fact that there is a lot of government policy not very careful, stable industry, cigarette ITC, stable industry. Even despite the fact that smoking is dangerous to health, but then there are many people who cannot do without smoking. So it will continue to be a stable industry. Food industry, all required, and food, these are all stable industries. So these companies, these industries, over a period of time, you can cover investing into emerging. See, when you're investing in emerging industries, you can make huge profits because if it succeeds, check an IT. But in a stable industry, you may not be able to make huge profits. Again, you can't make huge profits in Hindustan Lever or an ITC because there is no. See, when you can make more money is something where there's an uncertainty. Where there's uncertainty, the level of growth. So uncertainty in terms of positive uncertainty. Okay, a company may grow 30%, 40%, 50% if an industry, emerging industries. But in emerging industries, a lot of these emerging industries decline. So there's a risk involved. So higher risk, higher gain. But in a stable industry, you can't make 100% in a Hindustan Lever because everybody has an IDC. Because there's nothing uncertain. You know the growth. Or a double. You know the growth. So these are the industries, we have stable industries. In a stable industry, you won't lose over a period of time. But you will not make phenomenal returns. Like you cannot make one IT startup. See, food industry and cigarette industry is there for so long. So there's no question of it as an emerging industry. An emerging industry in IT or electronics or electronics, they can give you huge returns. That may not happen in a stable industry. Now, stable industry, when you look at stable industry, there are three categories of stock which you qualify as blue chips or defensive stocks and income stocks within these industries. Blue chip are stocks which, no, blue chips are known as the best stocks, blue chips, that they cannot fail. The stock like Hindustan Lever, ITC, PCS, they call it blue chip companies. Quality of stocks, you see, they are called blue chips. Then defensive stocks are stocks like where even defense are like the stocks in the food industry. They are defensive stocks. They will not move down even if the economy moves down. Okay, everybody requires food. You're all going to. You don't decide that if the economy is 10%, I will eat this much, and if the economy is 4.5%, reduce my consumption of it. It doesn't happen. So whether the economy is the basic necessity of food will have irrespective of the economy. So we don't reduce it.
Pharma,
okay, pharma is stable. But in pharma, there are a lot of blue chip companies in the pharma industry. Like a Glaxo will be able to, because their products, okay. They're research based product, like Glenmark research based. The research may, the product, after clinical trials, it may succeed or not succeed. So there's a risk. But when you have stable products like here, now today, most of the ailments you're having, most of the ailments here are stable products. So they don't, so those are blue chip companies. Blue chip stocks.
In general sense, the term blue chip denotes shares of top investment quality companies which maintain earnings and dividends through good times and bad. This record reflects a dominant market position, strong internal finances, and effective management. Shows strong growth in sales and earnings. Blue chip stocks offer more guarantee of continued performance as companies' fortunes can and do change.
Sometimes blue chips can also change because the industry, the company, they're very. See, if you look at the companies, all great companies of 1970s no longer exist. All great companies of 1980s don't exist today. They were blue chips at one point of time. At one point of time, I know Seven Seas Transportation. Which was a shipping company, was a blue chip company. Today the company is non-existent. Company like Orkay Silk Mills was a blue chip company. Because Orkay Silk Mills was a very blue chip. Today the company is already there. Metal Box, everybody sees this Metal Box is a great company at that point of time. Today it doesn't exist. Premier Patmini, Hindustan Motors, I can give examples. See, over a period of time, changes. When we come to family managed companies, the family, there may be a family which has been Mafatlals, Singhalias, Modis. Today, Mafatlals was a great group in 1980s. Today, Mafatlals non existed. So, family businesses degenerates. So, which we again come to, there is one, except for multinationals, when we were taught at the beginning of our careers, one thing, you may marry a wife but never marry a stock. And when you marry a stock, if that is the first lesson, never marry a stock. Because all growth is temporary and must be capitalized on. If you look at growth of any industry, over a period of time it has deteriorated. Growth of any family, very few exceptions, multinational, because they are perfectly managed. But you have the Singhania family, which they are deteriorated. You have the Mafatlal family, the Modi family. Could give you many, many, many examples where at one point of time in the 1960s, 70s, 80s, all the groups which are in the 80s. So you must have, if it is a professionally managed company, it will continue. But if it is a company which is not professionally managed, so all growth is temporary. Now coming to the blue chip companies in general, like Hindustan Lever, we can consider it as a blue chip company. Hindustan Lever is, how do you consider quality? When you see that their blue chip denotes shares of top investment quality company. What is the top investment quality? Hindustan Lever is a top company. It is into Colgate, Gillette. These are companies which are top quality companies. They are backed by competent managements, where a competent management is a management which can take the company forward even in adverse circumstances. Because you require top quality managements, managements which are of low quality will succumb to economic adversities. But a top managed company will always see that it grows. So quality companies which maintain earnings and dividends, Hindustan Unilever will keep on paying you dividend every year. There are certain companies will pay you dividend 1 year, skip dividend next year, or don't pay dividend for next 2 years. Hindustan Labour, ITC, Colgate, all these can be Glaxo, they are considered blue chip because they have top quality management. They have a dividend policy every year, they increase their earnings, they increase sales, and they have a market, dominant market position. Today, Gillette, Colgate, Labour, Procter & Gamble, they have a dominant market. You can't shake them. Or you cannot compete with them. So, if you invest in these companies, you will get a good growth, steady growth, maybe not a growth which is like some of the emerging industries give you, but you will have decent growth. So, therefore, as we come into you balance to you have companies with blue chips and certain stable industries, certain portion you can put in emerging industries to increase the return on average return on your portfolio. So,
Defensive stocks are considered to be shares of companies with stable earnings and dividends records and ability to clock boundary conditions. Although food is a necessity of life, price competition at the retail level can put pressure on profit margins.
So now Hindustan Unilever is also into various, also into foods. ITC is also into foods. These are called defensive stocks because during the periods of recession, as I said earlier, you don't cut up on consumption of your food, so it's a necessity. As you said, pharma also, you do not cut down on your medicines. But in pharma, there are certain companies which are into research-based. Those companies may not be blue chips or may not be defensive stocks because their earnings fluctuate. But in specifically companies which are these, I could consider Colgate as a defense stock because necessarily you must shop it every day. So these are companies which have stable products, stable and stable demand. These are called and although food is a necessity, yeah, food as an industry will grow, but within the industry there will be competition of companies. So this is also important as an industry. Now I'll give you a classic example. The telecom industry. Let us take a simple example, mobile phone applications. Okay. Now, take a period 25 years back. 25 years back. was their mobile phone in existence? 25 years later, what is the growth of the mobile phone industry? When it started, many people thought that it would be beyond the reach of most. Nobody could have imagined that today the maids own mobile phones, the vegetable vendors own mobile phones, the person who's a carpenter owns mobile phone, which was perceived many years back, no. So mobile phone industry has grown enormously over the last 25 years. So the industry has grown. Now what I'm trying to emphasize here in your selection of talks, the industry has grown. But within the industry, companies are not net profit. The industry has grown because 16 companies, competition. Everywhere in the world there are 4 or 5 mobile companies, 16 companies. The passenger car industry has grown from 30,000 to 50 lakhs. But most companies within the passenger car industry have not made profits, barring Maruti on the passenger. The Maruti is a different thing because of intense competition. So when you are looking at industry and concluding that the industry has grown 100% and I'm going to buy the stock, then you have to look at the state of competition. Like, as give you an example, the mobile companies don't make money. They have invested. Maybe now there will be shake up, consolidation, merging. Yeah, this happens, then there will be shake up. When they don't make money, the best companies, the strong companies will buy out the bigger companies. And then from 16 companies, we'll have about 4 or 5 companies. Then they will make profit. So this happens in consolidation, will happen at a point of stake. So it is not necessary that because you are in a stable or you are in a defensive, you make money. Because if there is competition, then in that case, some of the larger companies don't make money. Income stocks
are shares providing a generous dividend yield that is relatively well assured. By the same token, it may imply relatively low degree of price or volatility and limited capital appreciation potential. However, not all stocks with high yields may be income stocks.
Income stocks are those companies which give you regular dividends. They give you regular dividends. There may not be, say, for utility companies. Say, now, electricity companies. Say, in electric companies, they have a formula. This is what on return on their formula, this is how they can price. So they will not grow. Electric companies will not grow. But they will get steady income every year because they are guided by a particular formula. They will earn income from that they will distribute. So therefore, they are income stocks. If you want only an income stock which doesn't give you any yield, which doesn't give you any growth, say a Tata Power, good income stock, because it gives you today the price, if you look at your dividend and what is a good income stock. But it may not give you that kind of growth, because these are some industries which are regulated. When they are regulated, they cannot, their profits are limited. In fact, the income and profits are limited. But they assure. So to the extent they give you a fixed, they give you a dividend, so you can put that into your portfolio as a, but they will be high yielding stocks, but less of growth. But it does not mean that high yield stocks are always income stocks. This means that there may be a particular company which is giving a dividend. One year may give a high dividend, so it become a high yield stock, but next year it may not give a dividend. Or a company may be giving a dividend of 10% or 20%, and its stock price, which was 100 rupees, has come down to 30 rupees. So the yield increases, but that's temporary. So not all high yielding stocks are income stocks. But income stocks have to be taken on based on an industry which is stable industry, like an electricity, Tata Power, etc. They will give you fixed return because their profits are capped at a particular level.
Cyclical industries. A cyclical industry is one in which earnings are particularly sensitive to business cycles. Few, if any, industries are immune from the adverse effects of an overall business downturn. But the term cyclical applies to those where the effects on earnings are pronounced. Examples of cyclical industries include steel, cement, automobiles, household appliances. Some companies are affected by seasonal factors which should not be confused with cyclical considerations. Brewing industry, sales higher in summer months than during other periods of the year?
So these were the companies in era were stable earnings. See, of food industry, say food, depending on what category of food you are, that will be a stable industry because the consumption pattern will be identical, similar throughout the year. So it is not cyclical or cyclical. But there are companies whose fortunes depend on so many factors. Like for example, the companies which companies or industries which depend on the basis of monsoon. They are monsoon, see agriculture is monsoon related. So these are, if next year the monsoon fails, then what happens is industry also fails. So that's it. Then the automobile industry depends on interest rate. Then also, then there is companies which have got festive demand. They depend on festivities, festive demand. Then there are seasonal. Like for example, generally, the people who are in the umbrella business will sell it only in monsoons. Non-monsoons, you don't have a demand for that. I don't think you will keep an everybody will have umbrella business moving on. Maybe for sun as well, maybe very small percentage. But the demand is only during monsoons. Beyond monsoons, there's no demand. And then, brewing industries, sales are at the quarter center business here. People will have more beer during summer than in winter. So, yeah, these are the brewing industries. The demand would be at a particular period of time. So, every industry which is cyclical will have demand based on it. It could be seasonal, the demand which is different. There's no cyclical, seasonal. Because every year there will be demand. But perhaps, so it's this way, right? Perhaps, see, the demand is just generally theory that if monsoons fail, the demand for umbrellas reduces, despite the fact that they are seasonal. So, but still, it depends on the nature, it depends on the vagaries of monsoon. So, even agriculture, there are certain food products which will depend, their output will depend on the success of the monsoons or failure of the monsoon, either way. So these are cyclical industries which are there. So when you are investing in cyclical industries, you have to also take into consideration these factors that they will not give you an earnings which is stable. The earnings will fluctuate based on the outcome of the event. If it is a monsoon, it's based on monsoons, then perhaps if monsoons are good, the sector will do well. Monsoons are not good, the sector. So there, what you have to monitor when you are monitoring the company, you have to monitor the event which will affect the profitability of the company. Speculative industries.
Speculative industries, while investing in stocks involve risks because of ever-changing stock market values, the word speculation is usually applied to industries or stocks where the risk and uncertainty are unusually high due to absence of definitive information. Emerging industries can often aptly be termed as speculative. The profit potential of a new product or service attracts many new companies and initial growth may be phenomenal. Typically, however, an inevitable shakeout occurs and many of the original participants are forced out of business as the industry consolidates.
Decision in the decision making. and these parameters vary from company to company. Now, talking about company analysis, as each company will be unique in the way it does business, finances, operations. So company A will differ from company B, company C will differ from company B, just like as each individual different. If you are given a project to manage, each one will manage it in a different way. Some of you may manage it very efficiently, I don't want to say, and some may not manage it in an efficient manner. So how you handle a project is important, and that has relevance to its outcome. So when you do company analysis, there are two broad components. One is the qualitative aspect, and two is the quantitative aspect. Now there are certain, in terms of quantitative, there are certain things which could be put into figure format. The company sales, you could put into format. The company A has got a turnover of 100 crore this year, 120 crore next year. Okay, then you can arrive at a conclusion that a company from 100 crores to 120 crores has grown 20%. So there's a quantitative figure there. Okay. But there are certain different kinds of qualitative. It is something which is intangible. Now, as far as the dynamism is concerned, the aggression, there may be company A and company B. Company A has got a management which is very aggressive. That cannot be quantified in terms of, it cannot be quantified. That's an intangible, aggressive of the management. Then the vision of the management. There are certain managements which can think in 3 years beyond. There are certain managements which can think 5 years beyond. Or certain managements which can think 10 years beyond. So they chart out the growth for the next 10 years. And there are some companies with a limited vision. There may be companies with limited vision. And so what they see the horizons is limited. Then the process of a company is a qualitative. How a company is managed, the procedures the company has, then the corporate governance systems. These are all qualitative aspects. You may have a company, then how it conducts its business, then its employee relationship. See, a particular company, a particular management may have very important relationship with its staff. It can motivate the staff, it can inspire the staff and get great results. There will be certain companies which management do not have cordial relations with the staff. There are always politics and infighting, and that affects performance. These are the qualitative aspects which are intangibles. But as far as the quantitative aspects are concerned, the financial statements in terms of ratios, in terms of turnover, profits, net worth, return on capital employed, return on net worth, these are the which you can see under quantitative basis. Now, company and these are the earning statements. Sales. A company's ability to increase sales, then increase product prices, increase product volumes, increase introduction of new products, expansion in new geographical markets, consolidation of a company acquired in a takeover, the initial contribution from new plant or diversification, a temporary increase in sales due to strike at a major competitor. Now, okay, apart from, I would like to emphasize on this a temporary increase in sales due to a strike at a major competitor. You may find, see today, industrial relations are cordial, not as it was in the past. In the past, even if you look at the industrial relations landscape in Mumbai, you had unions. You had a Shiv Sena union, you had a Datta Saman union, which always were instrumental in creating labor relations problems. So you had a lot of industrial unrest in a lot of companies. You had a company like, I remember, Siemens, which was on strike for 9 months. You had certain companies which were on strike for a year. And then, you had all the textile companies in Mumbai which were on strike for so long, and it was organized by Datta Saman. So those are. But there is another side of the story, because many people who I talk to say that as far as Datta Saman was concerned, maybe he was a union leader, but he was more of a management. and the very fact that he organized a prolonged strike in the textile and lower Barel, and which forced most of the managements, long strike, forced most of the managements to close their factories and sell their land at huge, and today you see what has happened in lower Barel, its value has increased tremendously, and the laborers over there, the scrap laborers, they are nowhere. So, industrial relations at a point of time, the strikes used to take a very, very long period of time. And during that period, so I'll give you an example. There's a company today known as Bosch, earlier it was known as Myco, Motor Industries, Spark Plugs. So, at a point of time, there's another computer, Delhi-based J Engineering, never made profits. But when Myco, at the time, Motor Industry was strike for a long period of time, J Engineering made a good profit because of the computer being on strike. Now, if you look at a company and look at a balance sheet and say it's made phenomenal profit without taking into consideration their history, you get wrong results. So, when you look at a company, also, what is the reason of increasing sales? Which again, whether it's product, whether it's volume increase, or it is value increase, unit increase. So, this every increase in sales due to a strike at a competitor. And when you look at an increase in sales, you should not be enamored with the performance. The performance is because the major competitor strike and there is no competition. So a company which works in an environment where there is no competition will give you a distorted picture. And that lack of competition is temporary in nature. So the moment competition gets restored, the profitability again falls. Then, a company which has increased sales because of aggressive advertising and promotion, whether it is sustainable. At times there are certain products, they are fancy products, first time trial, subsequently the products are not well accepted, and it is because of the advertising and promotion that it will be temporary in nature or it will be permanent in nature. Upswing in a business cycle. Then, favorable impact of government legislation that we take it in a different slide. Between product volumes and price increases. If a company has increased its production from 100 units to 150 units, then there is an increase in production. Now, or the company may have increased its sales not due to increase in unit but increase in price. Now, you have to find out whether the price is sustainable or not sustainable, because then if a company has increased its sales because of price and subsequently, maybe 6 months later, there is competition coming in, the price will fall down, the price will scale down. And therefore, it will be raised, the company status will be then back to its position. So, you have to look at whether the increase is due to price increase or volume increase. Expansion, introduction of new products. Okay, introduction of new products, and if the new products are successful, it will increase the value of the company. New geographies, the company may be restricted to a particular geography, it may be regional, it goes pan-India, then it goes global. So that increases the company's size and also increases the company's performance. Next, a company is efficient. You have to, okay, apart from sales growing, cost. If the sales are growing by 10% and the costs are growing by 20%, don't have to get the company, whether it's an efficient or inefficient company, you have to look at it. Cost further, because a company's success, how you look at a company's success is the profit or profitability as a ratio of profit. Sales growing, good. Also the cost, as the sales grow, the cost should come down and not go up. Because when sales grow, as you said, then there are two types of costs which a company incurs: fixed cost, variable cost, which means a cost that is fixed will remain there whether the company produces 1 unit or 100 units. There's either a fixed cost and a variable cost. Variable cost will increase along with the production increase. Let us say a company has to pay, a company has got a 1,000 square feet area on rent. It is paying the owner rent of, let us say, 1 lakh rupees per month. Now, let us say at the same time, the company in one produces 0 units. Will the owner of the premises tell the company that you are paying zero, you are producing zero, so pay me zero rent? Yes, no. So it will have to pay the rent irrespective of its output, so that's a fixed cost. Electric cost may be variable. Electric cost is variable because as it produces more, the cost moves up. That's a variable cost. So which means as the company increases itself, say today it has a turnover of 1 lakh and it pays, let's take only basis of rent, a fixed cost. 1 lakh turnover, 1 lakh rent. So 100% of its turnover is being absorbed by rent. Now, if the company increases its production from 100 units to 200 units, then it increases further from 100 units to 1000 units. And let us say the turnover moves up from 1 lakh to 10 lakhs. Will the rent move up to 10 lakhs? Yes, no. Rent will be fixed. So earlier, when it had a turnover of 1 lakh and rent of 1 lakh, it was 100% of the cost. 100% of the sales was rent. And as it moves up from 1 lakh to 10 lakhs, then rent as a percentage of sales will be 10%. Which means as you keep on increasing your turnover, as you keep on increasing your output, the fixed costs keep on decreasing. Because then they emerge as a smaller component of your turnover. So when the company is increasing its turnover, then you also have to see that cost should decrease. If you find that company's cost increasing along with the turnover, then that is not a good investment because there's something wrong. But there are times when you may find that the company's turnover increasing, but profits decreasing. That is possible, but then you have to look at a certain factors, government policy. Favorable, unfavorable. Economic reforms and policies towards sector play in telecom industry. Now, government policies. You see on the government policies of aviation, open sky policy or 49.9 insurance, aviation, insurance, FDI retail for direct investment to retail. So, what are the policies? Now, the policies on retail then it may affect or benefit the existing companies. Aviation, now the government has opened the skies. Competition is intensified. If you look at all airline companies, including Kingfisher, which is no law, but all airline companies are making loss except IndiGo. I don't know how they are making profit. Airline companies don't make profit because airline companies, if you look at airline companies, broadcasting companies.
IndiGo is not listed, that is why it is making profit. The others are listed, this side of the
But since you see, what is, as far as the parameters, the biggest single factor for the single biggest factor for all airlines is aviation urban fuel. Fuel. Now, as far as fuel is concerned, the price generally is available. So that's the biggest employee cost, manpower cost. These are the two biggest factors in an airline. And what I am told that in certain industries, the promoters enter into an industry more for the glamour aspect than the business aspect. Like, I have certain people to my friends who are into certain industries, even the broadcasting industries, all the broadcasters are making awesome, for the glamour part of it. And you go, Kingfisher, look at the flamboyance and when the airline was. But you're right because it's public money. So you can.
IPL, formula racing. Not to mention other things.
Getting public money. So this is the policies of the government which affect, benefit or affect. So you have to always look at the government policy or the industry is loophole. Then that industry will not do well and maybe it may not qualify as an industry. Then this is that all you know, I don't have to emphasize. expansion. Very, very important, expansion. Because let's say a bank has one branch. Today, next 2 years, same one branch. 5 years, one branch. 10 years, same branch. Will you invest in a company or not? Why? Because it's not growing. So all of you want companies to grow. So therefore, you have to identify companies which are growing. And they have to grow into an industry also. Into an industry where there is a demand. This is a wrong example, but I mean, just for the sake of it. A company, the demand for, let us say the demand in the banking sector, this is just an example, is the demand is 20, all of you like companies which are growing. So one branch company don't like it. But if the demand for banks, there are only a demand for 20 branches, and a company is setting up 100 branches, would you like it? Why?
Because the requirement is only 20 branches, and you are going to open up 100 branches, which would be a loss.
So therefore, when you are looking at demand, when you are looking at expansion, you have to look at the demand. Many companies expand at a point of time and there is no demand. Demand is growing, same companies like India, demand to grow, but at certain industries are becoming like declining industries. So if a company is expanding in a declining industry, then it's a recipe for disaster. So you look at the industry. What industry? It makes sense. Banking industry, yes. India, there, as far as India is concerned, as far as country is concerned, the demand for virtually every product or every segment is enormous. We are a country, vast country, 132 crore population, and by 225 or what it is estimated that we, our population will be more than China. Almost 50% of our population is below the age of 25, so great potential. So demand is great, except the government intend to push this demand. But whatever, if you look at the banking sector, it has not penetrated, still it will penetrate. The auto sector, which is also a proxy for the economy, like our territory quarters, these are the business of motorcycle. Rural penetration is not there. And what else we are talking that today, the demand in the sector which is enormous for a simple reason that we have a population of 132 crore population. Of that, 50% of the population below 25-30 years, that is the average age of the population. And for individuals below the age of 25-30, what is their mode of transport? Motorcycles. So therefore there is a lot of under-penetration. It's a very, very huge market. It takes time for the market to develop, because it also has to be, and then in the youth, what do you have in today's youth? Rising income and rising aspirations. So all those things get together. So in time, as we go forward, India has got a huge potential for growth. Unfortunately, it is not backed by the right politicians who can spur it, because in the quest for retaining their seats, growth is sacrificed. And when you look at what happened to the UPA government, all projects which could, whether it is FDI, in aviation, in insurance, all have been stalled by the Mamata Banerjee, because each one is looking for their own self-interest rather than the interest of the country, which may not be in other countries. So here, much of the growth is stalled because of internal politics. If we have a strong government, and we have a strong government, then India can be one of the fastest growing economies, considering the fact that we are an English-speaking country, we have the entrepreneurship talent, because everywhere in the world you go to anywhere, in little India, everywhere in the world, because Indians are enterprising. So that enterprise is there, but the enterprise unfortunately is installed because of government policy. But someday you can't, as I say, you can't stop everything. You know, one thing which is constant is change. You can't stop change. Therefore, at various points of time, if you look at Indian history, there were roadblocks. Whether it was through computerization, when computerization came in, all the banks, etc., and all the government organization, we tested it because nobody wanted this. But it has come. Then, whether it is in the policies of the government in bringing foreign investment into various sectors, there was a lot of criticism and of opposition. but that also has come true. So in the long run, you cannot. And today, what is we are continuing to satellite TV, we're exposed also to TV, to internet, we're exposed to foreign performances and culture. So slowly, slowly, that is also getting imbibed, and we will change. And definitely, the potential in India is great. So every product, that we will talk about demand, see, most of the products, except declining products, which will come to, have no demand. But any expansion is important. Maruti started at 1 lakh vehicles. Today it is 15 lakhs, and it will go up to 20 lakhs. Now, what is the advantage in expansion for HDFC's bank started at one branch? Now, why expansion and why it is important for expansion? Because let us say that HDFC started with one branch. You bought the shares of HDFC. Now you cannot see, either you own a business, one which you control, or you are part owner of a business which you don't control. Now if I want to set, I want to get into banking industry, I have to start a bank. Now I am not competent to start a bank. I don't have a team, that's not myself, so I'll never be able to start a bank. But I can enter the banking business by my first shareholder. Very shareholder, so you enter into. So now, if you have bought HDFC, when it was one bank with one branch, what were you? You were the owner of a company, a part owner of a company with one branch. Today, HDFC has over 1,000 branches. So today, over the last several years, you are now the owner of part owner of 1,000 branches. That is growth. You are a part owner of one branch. Now you are owner of 1,000 branches. One branch was giving you this much of profits, 1,000 branches giving you so much of profits. So your value has grown exponentially, your value has grown enormously. So that is how you look at expansion. When you bought share of Maruti, you are a part owner of 1 lakh vehicles, part owner of a company with 1 lakh vehicles. Today you are a part owner of a company 15 lakh vehicles, and shortly you will be a owner with 20 lakh vehicles. So that is growth and that is expansion. That is how companies expand and grow. Yes Bank, one branch to 750 branches. And Yes Bank is going to be the next HDFC. So today if you invest in Yes Bank, hold, your wealth will grow. Similarly, HDFC will not stop at 1,000 branches. There is a lot of scope for banking. So it is here where you invest in a company and that investment. See, but there is a lot of, when you make investment, like, and this is again, I'll give you example. A person, let's say, investor will buy a Yes Bank. The price of the share is just now it's about 320 rupees. You buy 350 rupees, the share price comes down from 350 to 320. Then the investor gets worried. So the price has come down, I should sell. Because the price has come down, may come down further. My question or response, you have to look. See, share prices will keep on fluctuating as gold prices and commodity prices keep on fluctuating. You have to look at, don't look at a price, look at a business. If Yes Bank is going to expand from 750 to 1,000 branches, you look at 1,000 branches at bank, don't look at a price, prices fluctuate. And the same people, the same person, they will invest in a fixed deposit and never look at after 5 years, renewed again. So fixed deposit renewed 5 years. And looking, I reminded simply how people, or some people look at shares. There was a particular lady who got married a little late, and her husband was working for a multinational company. So she wanted to invest in a multinational company as fixed deposits, and she said, I'll get a stream of income that will take care and put the money in a fixed deposit in this company. And then when my husband retires, 6 years, this is the amount of accumulated wealth will be have to a fixed deposit. So my response is, instead of putting money, it's a partnership company, it's a good company, multinational, instead of putting money in fixed deposit, which will not beat inflation, why don't you instead put money in a company shares? She said, no, I won't do that. When I asked her the question, why won't you do that? She said, what happens if the company closes down? Now see the paradox. She is convinced when her husband puts in money in a fixed deposit, till retirement the company will remain. But when he invests in shares, the company will collapse. Now, that is a paradox. The chances the company shares are more greater because the company may give, may, the company may decide to buy back and buy a share at a higher price and give a, and give a husband a voluntary retirement, what happens then? That is the, here, the longevity of the company is more assured than the husband's job in the company. That is what you don't look at. That's why we have a mental block. There's a lot of mental blocks which I come across. So, expansion is something which, as the company expands, it brings you more revenues. And we'll see that the companies, if you are invested in great, great companies, which have given they come certain companies, which some of the companies I said, which have transformed paupers into billionaires. That is the strength of investment in great companies, not in all companies. Again, it's a rider. Not in all companies. Declining industries, declining companies, or speculative companies. People make the mistake. The people make the mistake, as I said. I would say a share at 100 rupees may be cheap, and a share at 5 rupees will be expensive. But a person will look in absolute terms. 5 rupees, buy. 100 rupees, sell. Now, that is not the way. These are mistakes. Because when you ascribe a price, you look at the worth of the company. You look at a net, what is the value of the company. At 5 rupees, a company will be still expensive because a company may have a lot of liabilities, it will be running losses, it will be have so a lot of roles. Like, for example, some have done it, but it's not that, it's just that I'm not saying that any involved any type of skills or involved in it. But some of my clients and sometimes have asked me about when 30 rupees, 25 rupees to buy a better issue by. Because Kingfisher from 60 rupees has been declining. So there are people who want to buy Kingfisher at 25 or 20. Even at a particular level, have been disputing. But they feel that Kingfisher prices now. Now today, even at 5 rupees or 3 rupees, I won't recommend. It has got a liability of 7,500 crores. It is grounded. It is virtually, if you look at the liability, so it, in fact, they should, you should, instead of you buying, a company should pay. So, it is what you look at a company. For Kingfisher at 7 rupees or 3 rupees, actually is expensive. Whereas I would say TCS at 2000 is cheap. And I have got a valid reason that how you end up. At 2000, I would say, I would just now say that rightly with conviction that at 3 rupees Kingfisher is expensive and at 2000 rupees TCS is cheap. This is how you look at a company and not in absolute terms by way of, just by way of the price. Diversification. Now, there are companies which diversify. Now, how would you, many people tell me that we like diversified companies. But there I beg to differ. In most cases, I like focused companies. Now, why I don't like diversified companies and why I like focused companies is because then you are spreading your resources thin. If you are great in something, you focus on that, you will grow. If you go into many areas which are, so diversification can be related, unrelated. Like diversification, Bajaj Auto, from scooters into motorcycles is related. That is there. But diversification into unrelated areas, like Cadbury, now it's not listed, but it is a great chocolate company. But they went into ice cream, olives, they went into fruit juices, failed. MRF may be a great tire company, but if tomorrow MRF decide that I'll go and manufacture biscuits, I won't buy the company because they don't have any expertise in biscuits. Britannia is a great biscuit company, but it will be poor when it manufactures biscuits. Similarly, you find all the Asian Paints may be a great decorative brand, but if Asian Paints tomorrow decides to go into wafers, it will not succeed. Most chances is that it will lose money. So there are many companies which have gone into diversification, but unrelated diversification again is a source of is a recipe for disaster. This would not have been a biscuit company.
Diversifying its business into every field, but it's making profits everywhere.
I'll come to that, but I'll just recover. Reliance has gone into one. See, what you have diversified into telecom and into retail. But Reliance as such, if you look at Reliance, they have gone into backward integration. It's an integration, same raw material, they keep on producing the raw material, the backward integration lies. And now, Reliance has gone into industry, telecom, and if you look at telecom, they just not yet enter telecom, so into retail. But retail is a sunrise industry. There's no much any competition, there's no competition. As you go forward, let's see. With first, there you get early more advantage. In certain companies, you get early more advantage. And Reliance is a compliment giant, so they go into huge business, but you cannot get that. So, the MRF, getting into biscuits, see, totally getting into, say, MRF may get into a totally big business, which is related to gas. So, when Reliance has gone into, now success of Reliance into telecom will be proved later. But at the same time, if you look at Reliance has gone, so you cannot, in comparison, may not be very right, because Reliance today has got 4 lakh crore turnover. They have got size. So they can withstand competition in terms of time. They have got a staying power. So even in retail, say in retail, to the Bharti, Walmart, and then others are small players. So with that size, you have to have, you can compete at times with size. Retail is a sunrise industry, and they have got size. 4 lakh turnover, which company has got a 4 lakh turnover? 4 lakh crore turnover. Not 4 lakh crore turnover. So when you have that type of cash flows, that type of size, then you have a withstanding and holding power. Time and again, but I don't, they're not, see, what they have done outside is retail and now telecom. But telecom, they were already earlier there to Anil Ambani's company. So they're already.
Reliance Telecom and this is Rio.
Now, if you look at this, in their own business, if you look at it right up to oil, it is backward integration. See, when they started with textiles, they went on making the raw materials and each raw materials, they went to that extent that, okay, all this is part of the same division. Anyway, further you have, I'll give you questions and answer. So, focused companies are always better because they focus on their own business, which they have competent and which they have the skills.
Hello.
Yeah.
No, you can hear me?
No.
No, not very much.
No.
I don't hear you.
The caller mic has to be.